Hi to everyone and welcome to this Agilent Technologies webinar. Okay, right now I'd like to introduce today's presenter, Senior Applications Engineer John Screech. John graduated in 1986 with a bachelor's degree in physics and has worked since 1988 in analytical instrumentation. Now his career has spanned general mass spectrometry, vacuum system development, and contraband detection. John is currently based in Toronto, Canada, and supports Agilent's AFO sales team. John has lectured at over a dozen universities and national labs in Canada and the U.S. on vacuum technology since joining Agilent in 2011. So, John, with that, I'd like to welcome you to today's event, and I'm going to pass things over to you to get us started. So, John, go right ahead.
Well, thanks very much for that introduction. Let's get started with vacuum for physics research. As you know from the introduction and from signing up, this is going to talk about how we use vacuum for various aspects of physics research. We're going to touch on basically everything from large-scale particle accelerator space research to some maybe some not-so-common processes like quantum computing, and we'll give you some examples of how those people are using vacuum, and also why they require vacuum for that process and how they generate the types of pressures that are needed to undergo that or undertake that physics research. Before we do jump in, I want to just point out that the Varian company, now owned by Agilent, has been in the vacuum business for a long time. The Varian Associates was started over 70 years ago back in Palo Alto, California. Sigurd and Russell Varian, the two Varian brothers, were famous inventors, and in particular doing a lot of work with radio tubes, which is how they came about being involved with the vacuum business, having to create and measure vacuum environments. And they're also famous for the invention of the klystron tube, which was a huge innovation as a radio tube used for research and for the development of radar systems, particularly around the Second World War. And we'll touch on those klystron tubes again later. As I said, in 2010, the Varian company was acquired by Agilent Technologies. And since then, there's just been a real proliferation of new products under the Agilent banner, produced by the original, what was the vacuum division of Varian. So congratulations to Varian and all the people there for the achievements over the last 70 years, 60 years of since the first ion pumps were invented, and last year was the 50th year of the Torino facility, Varian's research and development site in Torino, Italy. Again, the topics we're going to cover, why we need vacuum, talk a little bit about some of the applications, the physics applications, and how they use vacuum. Then we'll get into some of the system design, some of the products used to create and measure high and ultra-high vacuums. Let's focus on those. And some tips and techniques for troubleshooting and for building and creating high vacuum systems. So I really like this graphic. This covers a broad range of vacuum pressures all the way from atmosphere down to what they're calling here the extreme high vacuum environment, down at the very limits of what we can measure and what we can create, that being 10 to the minus 12 torr. If we want to simplify our life a little bit, let's break vacuum down into just two regions. We're going to talk about rough vacuum and then high and ultra-high vacuum. And the reason we want to do this is because of the behavior of the particles in those two different regimes. We move from viscous flow, where the particles are having constant collisions with each other. And then when we get into high and ultra-high vacuum pressures, we're talking about molecular flow. And again, how we measure and create vacuum pressures in molecular flow is quite different than how we achieve those things in viscous flow. So when we talk about why we need vacuum for physics research, when we're talking about accelerators, we're talking about people that are moving particles over long distance and they're trying to avoid signal losses. So if we can imagine a beam of particles moving through a vacuum environment, every time one of those part of that beam would strike a background gas molecule, that would result in a loss of beam intensity. So by maintaining and creating ultra-high vacuum environments inside those accelerators, our researchers can preserve the intensity of those beams and not have particles be knocked off course. Also, the high-energy particles striking background gas molecules can give off X-rays, and that can create other challenges for the physics research in terms of shielding and things they have to do to protect against those high-energy X-rays. What I used to call maintaining a clean environment, let's repurpose that and use the phrase, let's modify the chemical environment. So using vacuum can change what's happening at a surface level of, let's say, substrates, particularly if we're talking about semiconductor that we put inside a vacuum environment. So that's an obvious reason why that we would need to have a clean environment created by vacuum pressures. And in the same category, I want to put in people like NASA that are changing the conditions around an object or around a piece of instrumentation. Let's think about a satellite that's going inside a large chamber that needs to be evacuated down to space pressures so we can see how that instrument would behave in that environment. So we're changing the chemical environment or the vacuum environment around a piece of instrumentation. And finally, a little shout out to a company ITL in Toronto, where I live. And this is a company that makes equipment for space research. And in particular, they make a type of moon dust. So people making components that are going to go into space and they want to understand how they would behave on a lunar environment can use one of ITL's chambers for doing that. It's kind of a neat business application, particularly using vacuum to create that space-like environment. And finally, what we want to talk about is a flow of energy and how basically electron beams and electron transfer happens within a vacuum. So one of the reasons we would need vacuum, let's say in a spectrometer or a particle accelerator, is that we're going to have high electrical potentials over with very short separations. And without removing the background molecules, we would simply experience an arc across that. I used to show a picture of a lightning bolt here, but this vacuum tube gives you a really good illustration of how energy is transmitted through a partial vacuum environment. When we talk about the flow of electricity, let's put a company called D-Wave inside here. They're doing quantum computing. We'll talk about them in a minute. And the free energy laser that's operating now at Stanford Linear Accelerator National Accelerator Facility in California, they are using a vacuum environment for a free energy laser. So those pulses, those laser pulses can build up in a vacuum environment. Another topic, another place that vacuums use to manipulate the flow of energy would be the production of the flat panel TVs that we're all probably sitting looking at right now. And those screens, the LED and OLED screens, are produced using vacuum processes by changing the environment over which energy can flow. That's a huge topic, and we're not going to get too much more into the production of screens, only what we lump in with the semiconductor bracket. When we talk about particle accelerators, really we need to create a vacuum environment. And what we're doing is we're accelerating particles to high speed and generally colliding them together to have these huge energies. And you'll see the scale of particle accelerators has gone up over time based on the larger and larger amounts of energy we need to understand smaller and smaller components. The largest accelerator operating today is the CERN facility, operating on the French-Swiss border. The large outer ring of CERN has got a 27-kilometer path length. So these are incredibly long distances these particles are moving. And you think about the physics environment we would need to achieve a path length of that without those particles being deflected or knocked off course. The current biggest accelerator running at CERN is the Large Hadron Collider. And this is classified as the largest operating vacuum system in the world. We're going to hear a lot of these largest, fastest, coldest kind of phrases in this presentation, just based on the big high energies that are involved in this fundamental physics research. The beam line at CERN runs those two 27-kilometer rings you can see in the illustration here. They run at a pressure around 10 to the minus 11 torr, so incredibly low pressures. This is maintained using a combination of ion pumps. In fact, the Torino, Italy facility was created to provide ion pumps for CERN. They also use an outer insulating vacuum which is created by a cryopumping system that we'll talk about a bit later. And that maintains a one-tor region for the recirculating of the helium lines and for the cryogenic magnets that help accelerate the particles to these fantastic speeds. I read somewhere that the speeds of the particles at CERN when it's operating at full power are somewhere just a few tens of kilometers below the speed of light. That sounds pretty impressive. So the types of vacuum pumps they would use at CERN would include ion pumps, cryo pumps, and finally getter material. And they'd use this really neat process of actually using the vacuum chamber itself to pump out gases. We'll talk about that. Just again, the scale of CERN here, they run 170 different hot ionization gauges or Baird-Alpert gauges around the accelerator ring. And they use over 1,000 rough vacuum gauges to measure those rough vacuum pressures in that insulating vacuum environment. So big numbers of products to maintain and to link and to organize. One of the newest accelerators under construction is not too far from my home here in Toronto. This is at Michigan State University, and it's the construction of the Facility for Rare Isotope Beams, or FRIB, and that's being built. And it's kind of unique because what they're doing, instead of accelerating, let's say, protons and antiprotons as they do at CERN, they're accelerating very heavy ions, particularly uranium. I think there's a spec on here about the type of or the energy of the beam they're going to have. So they've got, I think it says 5 × 10^13 uranium ions per second will be the intensity of the beams. And if you can imagine the type of magnets and accelerators and components to move those or get those particles up to high speed are quite different for a uranium ion mass 238 than they would be, say, for a proton or an electron. So this will be used to study rare isotopes that are not normally found or are very short-lived here on Earth. And I'll give you an example. Just one component or one section of the beam line. This is the medium energy transport beam. It requires pressures down around the 10^-8 tor. I've spent a lot of time at this facility. They use turbo pumps backed by dry oil-free scroll pumps to be able to maintain that. And just one example in this one section of beamline, they have one of these turbo stands or turbo stations every 2 meters along a 43 meter, along that 43 meter section of the beamline. I know that's a little bit small, this graphic there, but I'm just going to blow that up. And we can see here, this is just meant to be an illustration of kind of what they look like. So a lot of the inlet would be at ground level. They're going down into a tunnel and into the lower part of the accelerator, but you can see the large numbers of turbo pumps, and each of these would require a scroll pump to back or to evacuate the gas from that, all isolated by sliding gate valves to protect in case of a vacuum fault in the system. All right, let's move on to space simulations. This is the Glenn Research Center just outside Cleveland, Ohio. And this is called the world's largest vacuum chamber. And if you want to see some great video on this facility, you can Google the BBC verification of the Galileo's gravity experiment, where he used two grossly different masses showing that they fell to Earth at the same speed. So at the time, he had theorized that in a vacuum environment, that let's say a bowling ball and a feather would fall to the ground at the same speed. And that's the experiment they undertake in this BBC video, this BBC science video, that's a great look if you want to go and video it. So you can see the size of this chamber. You can see a person walking just about dead center of your screen. That's a person standing straight up. We've got some of the dimensions here. They're in meters. So it's about 30 meter diameter circular chamber and a 37 meter height. And this requires both an inner and an outer chamber. If you can imagine pumping this chamber down into the, let's say, the 10^-6 tor region, or even to much coarser pressures than that, the pressure on the outside walls would cause the walls to collapse. So what they do is they pull a rough vacuum environment on the outside of this chamber, and they're able to pull, in fact, quite high vacuums inside this chamber without fear of the walls collapsing. Let's look at some numbers. This chamber can get down from atmosphere to about 20 torr in 2 hours using these massive ref vacuum pumps. They get from 20 torr to about 10 to the minus 3 torr in about 4 hours, and get from 10 to the minus 3 all the way down to 10 to the minus 6 torr in 2 to 6 hours, depending on the conditions and the componentry inside that chamber. How do they do this? They use an awful lot of vacuum pumps. They use these huge turbo pumps, 2,200 liters a second each, and they've got 5 of those. But the bulk of the pumping is done with vapor jet or diffusion pumps. So they've got 16 48-inch diameter pumps. That gives them a total pumping speed with those diffusion pumps in the high vacuum regime of 700,000 liters per second. They also use cryo pumps, which are very efficient at removing water from inside this chamber. There's 10 48-inch cryo pumps, and their total pumping speed is around 600,000 liters per second. So how do you get a chamber this big down to pressures that low? You just put massive, massive amounts of pumping speed onto that chamber. Vacuum deposition. I'm not going to talk too much about the semiconductor production. As I said, this could be a whole lecture on its own. I'm just going to touch on some of the places we use vacuum. I'm using the Semiconductor Industries Association. That's where I got this great graphic from. And there's a lot more information, a lot more detailed information and on how vacuum's used inside this industry. From a mental point of view, the most obvious thing, as I mentioned, touched on earlier, is that we want to create clean surfaces so we can do our deposition onto a nice clean surface and not worry that I'm going to be depositing onto water. So I want to try and, by using vacuum, have those molecules come off the surface, and so that I can make a deposition onto let's call it a pristine surface. So why is vacuum important? If I have a chamber rough down to, let's say, 10 to the minus 3 torr, I've only got about 2 milliseconds in that environment before a monolayer, a single layer of water molecules will form on top of that surface. If I can get the chamber down to 10 to the minus 6 seconds, down to minus 6 torr, I'll have about 2 seconds in order to do a deposition before that surface will become completely contaminated with water. So in the semiconductor world, that's not quite long enough time, so they want to be able to get the pressures even lower. And down around 10 to the minus 9, I would have about 37 minutes to be able to make a deposition. I can build up layers of different molecules or metallic surfaces onto, let's say, a semiconductor wafer. And so the pressures would be somewhere in between that 10 to the minus 6 and 10 to the minus 9 torr when I'm doing deposition onto surfaces. Little cartoon showing the vacuum deposition, how that works. I've got another reason for requiring vacuum in this region is that if I'm depositing off a filament or my source, I want to make sure that those particles travel directly onto the surface and don't get knocked off course. So I'm delivering them typically with a change in electrical potential, and having them be driven into the surface to make that coating, which enables a lot of the processes that we require out of a semiconductor chip. And finally, it may not be obvious, but they also use vacuum to be able to move particles around. Think about things like chips being moved to different stages of a interrogation device or something like that. So pick and place stuff is done using vacuum. And also load locks. Every time we want to try and move a particle from an atmospheric environment into a vacuum environment, I don't want to break that high or ultra high vacuum inside my chamber. So typically I'll move it through a series of vacuum drops in pressure, and that's enabled by these devices called load locks. Okay, we'll talk about our other sort of extremes in the universe. This is probably a unique one. I remember seeing, I found out about quantum from a show on Nova a few years ago. And one of the things they touched on was the coldest place in the universe. So D-Wave, as I said, just outside Vancouver in British Columbia, Canada, they are producing quantum computers. And these will operate at very, very low temperatures. We're talking about 15 millikelvin. And that's 180 times colder than even interstellar space. So it is truly the coldest place in the universe, or at least it was at the time. And they're creating quantum computers, which use a qubits instead of bits for doing calculations. And they have some unique properties in a way that I don't completely understand. But the reference they seem to use is that they can both be zeros and ones at the same time. So one of these is installed. We're touching back to NASA here. So NASA and Google's quantum artificial intelligence lab uses one of D-Wave's computer. So how do they achieve this very low temperature? Well, first of all, they use our turbo carts, which consist of turbomolecular pumps backed by scroll pumps to be able to reduce the pressure around it. They create basically an insulating vacuum as basically a real high-tech way that the vacuum inside your furnace would help keep your thermos tube would help keep either your water bottle cold or your hot coffee warm. So that's done through an insulating vacuum. They get down to a certain pressure with those and then use a helium recirculation system to maintain those incredibly cold temperatures on that quantum chip. And those helium recirculators, based on the price of liquid helium and the volume of liquid helium that's involved, they would all be closed-loop recirculation systems, which are enabled by oil-free scroll pumps as well. One of the earlier particle accelerators that was built is the Stanford Linear Accelerator, built in Palo Alto, California. So this was, at the time, was the world's longest particle accelerator, running about 2 miles long in the complete beam line, or 3 kilometers for those people using metric. So it's a Department of Energy facility operated by Stanford. This facility was famous for discovering quarks. They first identified and proved the existence of quarks. And the original electron beam was accelerated using those klystron tubes. So you think about back to the very first slide when I talked about Sigurd and Russell Varian and their invention of the klystron tube. So here we are just down the road at Stanford's linear accelerator using those same vacuum tubes created by the Varian brothers, or invented by the Varian brothers, to accelerate particles up to close to the speed of light again. Based on the energy levels, as a particle accelerator, SLAC was eclipsed by some of the larger facilities as we moved on to required more and more high energy collisions to be able to discover new particles. And the facility was actually repurposed, or the beam line, a good piece of the beam line was repurposed in 2009 as a free energy laser. So we're talking about now we're manipulating the environment in which we're moving pulses of energy, or pulses of electrons, and we're getting them to form into a laser beam. And that all requires a vacuum. That's done by a combination of turbomolecular pumps and ion pumps as well. Okay, that's some examples. Let's talk about how we create and measure vacuum environments. This is a simple cartoon that I use in the basic vacuum course that we teach here at Agilent, of a ultra-high vacuum system. We're going to talk a little bit about rough vacuum pumps. So in effect, all high vacuum or ultra-high vacuum systems still require some sort of rough vacuum pumps to be able to deal with the exhaust, let's say, of a high vacuum turbo pump, which can't compress gas all the way up to atmosphere. They need something to take that exhaust gas away, compress it from, let's say, anywhere from 10 to the minus 2 up to 10 torr pressures, take that gas and compress it all the way up to atmosphere. So some of the examples, dry scroll pumps are fairly common in physics research. They would be used in all aspects from a semiconductor to particle accelerators. Reciprocating screw pumps is primarily used for physics research in the semiconductor environment. They're very good at handling some of the very aggressive acids and gas species pumped as part of the semiconductor process. And we're going to touch on blowers and oil-sealed rotary vane pumps. Not real common in the physics environment because of that possibility of background contamination or backstreaming of oil particles. However, on a chamber the size of that huge NASA facility, they are simply the best way to achieve the rough vacuum pumping needed to create those pressures. When we look at high vacuum, we're going to talk about compound turbomolecular pumps, compound meaning the combination of a blade stage and a molecular drag mechanism. We're going to talk about cryogenic capture pumps. So these would be using temperature to pump away or to capture particles, have them loosen up energy. They simply stick onto surfaces and are effectively removed from our vacuum system. Again, vapor jet or diffusion pumps aren't that common in physics research. However, we mentioned earlier on that large vacuum chamber that the NASA facility does use diffusion pumps. The biggest diffusion pumps made, I believe, those 48-inch diameter pumps for being able to get down to that 10 to the minus 6 torr pressure in such a huge volume of chamber. So getting the huge hundreds of thousands of liters a second pumping speed. When we look to high vacuum environments, we're going to talk about a couple of different types of ultra-high vacuum pumps. The sputter ion pump, a famous invention by the Varian brothers. Titanium sublimation pumps, sort of, in my mind, a variation on the same theme. And then, as I also referred to when we talked about CERN, is these non-evaporative getter surfaces or getter materials that are used to pump. And we'll see those in primarily in particle accelerators. All right, very quickly, when we're creating rough environments, rough vacuum pressures, here we see an image of a reciprocating scroll pump. So these are very industrial-looking pumps, but durability is their claim to fame. So it's an oil-free environment. You can see those two scroll pieces are moving, or screw pieces are moving very close together, but there's no oil in between them. So it's free of contaminants, which is why it's liked by the semiconductor people. Typically water-cooled, and typically in the scientific world, fairly high pumping speeds, so above 100 cubic meters per hour. I mentioned a lot of the work that I see with our customers is using dry scroll pumps. This is the Agilent company is becoming a leader in this technology. We have either dual or single stage reciprocating scroll sets that can seal to millitorr or lower pressures without using oil. They're a clean, quiet alternative to oil-sealed rotary vane pumps, which is really the appeal for physics research, where they don't want to risk the potential for any oil backstreaming into their system that could contaminate the results or could result in, let's say, loss of beam performance. As I said, they can achieve low millitorr pressures. And really the advances recently in scroll pumps is be able to achieve low and lower pressures while using a single-sided scroll set, which gives you just really much easier maintenance and things like that. So dual-stage scroll pumps can get great ultimate pressures. However, the maintenance can be a bit of a challenge on them. Single-stage scrolls are much easier to work on. The maintenance on them is really just the tip seal change. It takes about 15 minutes, and a lot of those don't need to be done more than every couple of years. The large industrial size oil-sealed rotary vane pumps, again, this is the type of pumps that would be used in that great big vacuum chamber that NASA was using to test out satellites. And this here is a rotary vane pump on the bottom, and it's backed by, or it's operating in conjunction with a booster or a blower pump. And these get, the booster blower itself would accelerate the pumping speed from 10 torr to 10 to the minus 3 torr. So just at the part where the rotary vane pump was starting to lose its performance as we move away from the viscous flow environment, then the booster is very effective in that pumping region to help get you to the point where your high energy or high vacuum pumps can really take over and get the job done from 10 to the minus 3 down to 10 to the minus 6 torr in the case of that large NASA chamber. How do we measure rough vacuum? The most common vacuum gauge used in physics research in rough vacuum is the capacitance manometer. This uses a pressure differential between a reference pressure and the chamber pressure, and that difference in pressure would deflect a diaphragm, changing the capacitance of a circuit. So the reason these are used in physics research is they're simply the most accurate gauge out there, and they're fast responding, and they really don't care what gas they're measuring, so they have the same behavior for different gases. They're good for about 3.5 decades per gauge, so in order to cover a wide range of vacuum pressures, let's say from atmosphere down to 10 to the minus 3 torr, I'd need to buy probably two of these different range gauges and operate those in parallel. We can also use, in the rough vacuum regime, we can take advantage of the fact that a heated filament will lose energy to background gas molecules as they land on that surface and then leave, taking some of the energy with them. We can take advantage of, as I said, that change in the energy conditions and use that as a measurement, a direct or an indirect measurement of the gas density or the vacuum pressure inside the chamber. This Pirani gauge typically uses a Wheatstone bridge to do that. It's an electrical circuit, and as the heat is lost from the filament, changes the resistance of a circuit, which upsets the balance of the bridge. We apply a voltage to reestablish the balance, and that voltage would be indirectly proportional to the pressure inside the chamber. So we have to be careful using Pirani gauges. They're extremely nonlinear above one torr. And in particular, for gases, let's say if you're pumping an argon environment, they have the disadvantage that at some point they'll essentially stop responding to an increase in pressure for argon. And I had some students in a vacuum class that were working at a NASA facility, and they were saying in order to protect against chambers that they were backfilling with argon, they had to worry about overpressurizing the chamber, and they used a simple rough vacuum gauge, a boron gauge, just to make sure that they weren't overpressurizing that chamber because of the inability of a Pirani gauge to accurately read argon pressures at above a few torr. All right, let's talk about how we create high vacuum pressures. The simplest type of pump is the vapor jet or diffusion pump. This uses a hydrocarbon oil that's heated to high temperatures, goes up the central channel of this dip stack, it's called, inside the body of the pump, and exits at each of those three conical shapes, exits there at high speed, something like 750 miles an hour. We have a large hydrocarbon molecule striking background gas molecules and giving a momentum transfer towards the edges of the pump. The oil molecule is condensed back into a liquid by the water cooling jackets, drips back down into the body of the pump, taking that gas molecule with it. And eventually it's pumped away by a rough vacuum pump at the exhaust here. And you can see some of the baffles inside that exhaust to try and prevent the release of losing my oil mist out into my rough vacuum lines. Most common pump that we're going to see in high vacuum research is the turbomolecular pump. So these are high-speed devices consisting of a series of high-speed blades rotating around. In between each blade set, there would be a stationary stator with the complementary angle on it. Particles are struck by the blade, reflected off the stator, and we get a downward momentum down the stack from the inlet towards the exhaust of the pump. That blade mechanism is very effective, can pump gas from anywhere pressures as low as 10 to the minus 10 torr, all the way up to about 10 to the minus 3 torr. So it compresses gas by that degree, sort of seven orders of magnitude. At that point, we rely on a molecular drag stage. We can see here this to the left of the turbopump, this complex-shaped disc, and that's really only the top half of that disc. If you see them in a cross-section down about the middle stage or the middle section of the pump, there'll be a similar pattern on the underside of that. Particles by clinging to a spinning disc that's directly above that surface will get dragged along those channels. They'll flip from the top section to the bottom section and get dragged out towards the outer edge of the bottom half of that stator. And then that process repeats itself. We can have a total in this pump here, three separate of these twist door discs. So this is a novel molecular drag mechanism invented by Agilent, recently delivered in our current stream of turbomolecular pumps. Another critical component of turbopumps are the bearing mechanisms. I can see here I've shown the Agilent floating suspension design. Again, it's an innovation for us that's helped improve the robustness of turbopumps and also greatly reduced the amount of vibration transmitted, particularly important to people in the semiconductor business and, let's say, electron microscopes, where they're interrogating a wafer and looking at very small distances. And reducing vibration gives them a better image quality by doing that. Some of the other competitors will use a hybrid, so a combination of a mechanical and a permanent magnetic bearing. And in fact, perhaps the ultimate for these at the high end of the price range would be magnetically levitated turbopumps, where we use electromagnets to float, position, and spin that rotor. Finally, we're going to talk a little bit about cryopumps. So these would use very cold surfaces as a way to capture molecules inside a pump. So you can see there's no exhaust connected up to this pump. So we're simply waiting for what molecules to find their way in to the pump body in molecular flow, and having very cold surfaces particles will land on the surface, they'll lose so much energy, they won't be able to leave. And we have particular temperatures for doing that, 77 degrees Kelvin, so about 200 below zero on the Celsius scale, is very effective at pumping water. And then we have a second stage assembly, less than 15 degrees, and that's good for pumping argon, nitrogen, carbon monoxide, and some of the other gases. And we see some of the specs. The downside of these cryopumps is because they're only trapping molecules, they will have to be periodically regenerated. And the frequency of regeneration will be depending on the gas load and at what pressure you fire those up. When we get into the ultra-high vacuum world, the simplest design would be the titanium sublimation pump. So we can see in the upper picture here, there's three filaments in this design. So this is a three strikes kind of pump. I would get three shots at firing off a high current through that filament, vaporizing the titanium. It would condense out onto a colder surface, and that sort of fresh or unoxidized titanium would act as a getter. And by that I mean that components, gas molecules like nitrogen, will land on that surface, forming titanium nitride, and will be permanently attached to the surface. The titanium sublimation pump is really a derivation that came from the sputter ion pump. It's an invention of the Devarian brothers back in their labs in Palo Alto some 60 years ago. And this used a small plasma. We use the plasma to create molecular ions, so positive ions. We drive those into an end plate, and by hitting that end plate with high velocity, they'll actually sputter off titanium. So then we have that same gettering effect. The titanium will condense onto surfaces in around the body of the pump and act as a gettering mechanism, so to attract and trap nitrogen and hydrogen and oxygen and some of those other gas species that we're effectively pumping those away by permanently attaching them to the surface by forming those stable compounds. Great reference below here. That's an actual hyperlink if you're downloading this presentation. That's to a paper from CERN on the sputter ion pump development and how it's used in their facility. Non-evaporative getters, a technology I'm not that familiar with, but this is specialized coatings that are not titanium that are on the inside of chambers. They need to be activated typically through the application of heat, and once they've been activated, they will act as pumps by forming stable compounds with background gas molecules, much the same way that the sputter ion pump did, but they're doing this without using titanium, whether it's sputtered or sublimated. When I'm measuring high and ultra-high vacuum pressures, I use the same mechanisms. I need to move away from my mechanical or my thermal gauges and go towards ionization gauges. Two main types, the hot ionization gauge, or Baird-Alpert design, and the inverted magnetron, sometimes called a cold cathode design, is the invariant invention that actually led to the invention of the sputter ion pump. As we saw in that previous slide, same basic mechanism, creating a plasma using magnetic field to create movement of the electrons in the plasma, have them strike background gas molecules, and as those are delivered to an oppositely charged pole, we can have the measurement of that current be directly proportional to the gas density inside the tube. The hot ionization gauge, shown here, uses electrons from a filament to achieve the same process. We're going to create background ions, accelerate those towards a central electrode, and have the resulting ion current be picked up and measured as a representation of the pressure inside the chamber. So we can see here both the accuracy of the gauges, plus minus 20% of full scale for the hot ionization, plus minus 50% of full scale for the inverted magnetron or cold cathode design. And typically for UHV, let's talk about inverted magnetrons. Even though the fundamental design is of that cold cathode type, inverted magnetron was a big innovation for those gauges, which allowed them to be much more appropriate for ultra-high vacuum pressures. Operating range pretty similar for both of these gauges. Finally, if we're using an ion pump that we talked about on the previous slide, we can use the current between the anode and the cathode as being directly proportional to the gas density or the pressure inside the pump. Agilent controllers use a very clever thing called a step function, a step voltage feature, and by doing that we use a very high potential to create that plasma discharge. But once we have that plasma operating and stable, then we can reduce the voltage to the minimum level possible. By doing that, we reduce the leakage current and we get more accuracy in the measurement. And that allows simply using the ion pump controller itself to measure pressures down into the 10 to the minus 10 torr range. All right, let's talk about some troubleshooting for our high vacuum systems. Getting to UHV pressures, our pump down decay will go very quickly at the start, and then we'll slow down as we get into away from the free volume, get into pumping away our desorption gas load, diffusion gas load, and finally permeation. So the volume of the chamber, not really a factor in high and ultra high vacuum, only in the way that the larger volume chamber means a larger surface area, which is our desorption gas load. So desorption being gases coming off surfaces as we move to lower pressures, diffusion being the gas load coming from bulk materials that are inside my vacuum chamber. And finally, permeation we can think about as being, let's say, the overall leakiness of the chamber itself, being gases that are going to permeate through O-ring seals or through the walls and the body of the chamber itself. Sometimes we can think about things like a cast aluminum chamber, let's say, having a certain porosity and gas molecules being pulled out of the porous structure. And that's an understanding of permeation. If we want to think about getting to lower pressures, we need to think about all the potential gas sources. So we need to use these two graphs together. We think about what the different gas loads are and at what pressures they become the dominant factor. So if I manage to get my chamber down to 10 to the minus 9 torr from the scale or from the graphic on the left, I know that I'm down to really just seeing permeation leaks. And at some point, I'll start to see even backstreaming. So I'm seeing gas molecules going from the foreline of my high vacuum pump back through the pump and back up into the chamber. And at that point, my turbo pump has become a source of gas rather than a pump and is providing no net benefit. So I need to seal that off and really switch over to ion pumps if I wanted to get to lower pressure than that. When I'm looking at UHV chambers, I really need to get rid of all my virtual leaks inside the chamber. Most obvious example here would be a blind screw threads. We see that sometimes in high vacuum systems as a defect that would prevent them from getting to ultra high vacuum pressures. And real leaks, generally you've got rid of most of the large scale leaks. And we'll talk about some techniques for measuring and quantifying those leaks on the next slide. So challenges of getting to high vacuum and ultra high vacuum pressure. We've got to think about the materials we're going to use inside our vacuum chamber. There's an old adage that says, if I don't want to pump it away, don't put it into the chamber. So I got to very carefully choose and minimize the amount of material inside the chamber. Traditionally, back in the day, there was circuit boards were one of the biggest problems that we had to fight. And people trying to put circuit boards inside vacuum chamber were constantly outgassing. So when I think about HV and UHV pressures, I need to think about almost in order here, the permeation rates of material. That's going to be one of the fundamental limits I'm not going to be able to overcome, is the permeation rates of O-rings and seals on my chamber and the chamber itself. I really want to think about bakeout temperatures. Bakeout's the most effective way of increasing the outgassing rates to allow gas molecules to come off surfaces and be pumped away. I want to think about the outgassing rates themselves, the materials I've selected and what their outgassing properties are, particularly in the face of whether I can heat them or do some treatment to those materials to be able to reduce their overall outgassing rates. Chemical compatibility, mechanical properties, and electrical properties. It's interesting that in the rough vacuum regime, these would almost be in the reverse order in terms of importance. Finally, one of the most common questions I get asked on our basic vacuum class is about cleaning parts for high vacuum and ultra high vacuum. I've given up trying to provide recipes to people, but there's because of chemical compatibility and rules about what chemicals can be used in different facilities. So the best reference I can do here is to point you back to a paper from CERN. And again, this will be a hyperlink for anybody downloading this presentation. I talked about bakeout temperatures. The most effective way, as I said, to reduce the temperature of a high vacuum system is through the application of heat. We want to make sure that we're doing the heating uniformly throughout the chamber, which is why you can see all these voltmeters and potentiometers around the system attached to thermocouples. So I want to make sure that I'm heating everything up at the same rate so I don't have any hot spots and cold spots. Remember, all those gas molecules I'm liberating from surfaces are going to condense out on the coldest part of the system. So I want to heat and cool at the same rate. And one thing to note here is that increasing the temperature gives me an exponential benefit versus simply heating for longer time. Finally, some troubleshooting tips here. We can use the shape of the pump down curve to give us information about the vacuum system. I love these theoretical curves that you would see in a book here. That would be looking at the a real leak where we have a decrease in the slope of the pump down curve versus an outgassing leak or a desorption leak, and simply from inside the chamber, and that would typically show up as a steady state slope of that pump down curve. So it's interesting, in the basic vacuum course, we actually record these graphs. We take an example of a small chamber, we pump it down to our 10 to the minus 6 torr, say high vacuum pressures. And then we do the same thing by compromising the system by putting a hair across an O-ring. And as little as a gas leak as that can have the drastic effect of changing from the blue pump down curve in the graph at the bottom here to the red pump down curve, which certainly flatlines above the potential for this system. And here, if I want to look at the calculate the slopes at over 5 minute intervals, I can roughly say that the blue curve, once it gets through some initial pump down phase, ends up having a steady state, or a sort of, let's say, a flat line slope of that graph. So my slope in the first part is roughly the same as the slope in the second part, as we see for an outgassing leak. And the red line, or the red bars, would represent what we see with a real leak, is that slope is constantly decreasing, so going to lower and lower values. So these techniques actually do work. Another thing to think about with pump down curves, if I look at the shape of the pump down curve, if my behavior is roughly the same, but it's taking longer and longer to get to the same pressure, that might be an indication that I'm seeing some compromise in the performance of my vacuum pumps, whether it's my cryo pump or in a rough vacuum regime, maybe the rough vacuum pumps themselves. So that would be one indicator I might want to look at the pumps as being the source of the problem. Another technique we can use is the leak up rate. If you have the ability to seal off the vacuum chamber from the pumps that are attached to it, I can measure the decay in the vacuum pressure, or the amount of gas leaking into the system. And again, the shape of that curve can tell me some information about whether I'm seeing an outside in leak or an outgassing from the components inside the vacuum chamber. So those are great techniques. The pump down technique, based on the amount of time it takes and the information we get, is effective for relatively large leaks. The rate of rise test is a little bit more accurate, and that will give you the ability to identify leaks in the range of 10 to the minus 5 atmosphere cc's per second. That's the units we use to reference leak rates. We can see another technique, the radioisotope technique, that I'm not going to go into here. But if I really want to find small value leaks, so this would be 7 decades smaller leaks, I need a sophisticated device called a helium mass spec leak detector. So this is the new HLD device shown on the right of your screen here. So these are tools that customers would use. They would buy these to troubleshoot the chambers. And for large vacuum chambers, I want to connect that to the system under test between the high vacuum and the rough vacuum pumps. Take advantage. This is in the spray helium application. The new system is based around different applications for doing different methods of leak detection. I want to take advantage of the high pumping speed for helium of my high vacuum pumps on the system to be able to deliver gas to the inlet of this leak detector. And that allows me to locate and identify leaks in the system, and I can try and fix those and move on. For relatively small vacuum chambers, these have onboard pumps, and we can actually use the pump inside the leak detector to do that. They're anywhere from about 3 meters cubed per hour up to, I think, 15 meters cubed per hour is the largest oil-free scroll pump that we make inside this leak detector. Obviously, I wouldn't want to try and pump anything on the scale of that NASA chamber using only a 15 meter cubed per hour pump to do that. Finally, we can use the sniffing application with these for smaller components. And I would see this in the, let's say, the semiconductor industry, where they would pressurize a system with helium and try and sniff gas as leaking out from that system. And this variation on this would be, let's something called a bombing technique. And again, I've seen this in semiconductor where they're looking at destructive testing on components to measure the hermeticity of the component, which can be related to the lifetime of that component. All right, that's a lot of material to go through in just under an hour here. I hope that was useful for you. I just want to point out some of the other education programs we have available. And you can get in touch with my colleague Robin Ahrens in the training group, and she can give you more information, or our customer care number shown here on the screen. For very specific information on turbopumps, Agilent's produced an excellent series of care and use of turbopumps. And we can see just an example of how turbopumps would be used, unpacking and packing them, what components, and identifying the different subsystems on a turbomolecular pump. And finally, my colleague in the marketing department, John McLaren, has produced an excellent webinar on helium leak detection. If you want to know more information about that technique, including details of the HLD detector just released, you can click on the link. This will be an active hyperlink in the downloaded presentation, and go and access that information. All right, at that point, I hope we still have enough few minutes left for questions. I'm going to pass it back to Kim, and let's see if we can answer some questions from the audience. Thanks very much.
Thanks, John. And now we'll get to the Q&A. Well, we will have some time for questions. Okay, John, it looks like we're getting some questions in here, so I will hand things back to you.
Okay, thanks very much, Kim. Thanks to everyone that stuck through. This was, again, a ton of material to get through in I think it was, 52 minutes. With me today on the phone, I have Brian Mess, who's our North American's Operation Manager for Agilent Vacuum. So welcome, Brian. And let's
Hi, John.
See if we can take some take some questions from the audience. Okay. Our first question says, I'm confused by your slide on bakeouts. Are you trying to increase or to decrease the outgassing rate, and how does that help you get to a lower pressure? Okay, let me take a shot at that. On the slide referencing bakeout, I may have been a little bit unclear, because we do get sometimes twisted up a little bit in the technology using increase and decrease, and sometimes I mess up between the outgassing rate and the gas load itself. So really, if we think about the number of molecules on a surface, they are going to come off the surface at a relatively slow rate, which is why our vacuum chambers in the UHV take a long time to get to low pressures. And what we can do is, by applying heat, is we can accelerate the rate that those particles come off the surface. And by doing that, so we're increasing for a short time during bakeout the outgassing rate, and then when we stop baking out, we have a lower overall gas load, and that allows, with our fixed pumping speed, allows us to get to a lower pressure. So I hope maybe that's cleared up some of the confusion I may have caused myself in the description of bakeouts. Brian, anything to add on bakeouts that can maybe help this caller out?
You know, it's one of the best ways if you're trying to get down to lower vacuum. It's well worth the trouble to hook up heaters and heat your system for bakeout. I mean, it's in some places it's critical, but it really is worth the effort to invest in it.
Absolutely. Okay. Next question. This is one referring to the cartoon or the graphic of the UHV system I showed. It says you showed a system having a turbopump and an ion pump. I thought if you had an ion pump, you didn't need a turbopump. So this question, I guess, is somewhat true. In fact, in the earlier times of UHV systems, some of our customers would have a simple system that would have a rough vacuum pump to get the chamber down. Let's say we're using dual stage pumps, we can get down into the 10 to the minus 3, maybe into the 10 to the minus 4 torr range. And while technically that's low enough pressure to turn on an ion pump, we don't really recommend that here at Agilent. In fact, you know, there's a few reasons. For one thing, it's your ion pump is a capture pump. So it's going to be trying to contain molecules inside the body of that pump. You have a fixed amount of titanium available to do that. And we really don't want to spend our effort and our energy of our UHV pump trying to pump things away through the low-high vacuum area, where it's quite easy for pumps like turbopumps to get rid of those gases. And in fact, the turbopump's actually a much better pump at working in that operating range between, let's say, 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 7, 10 to the minus 8 torr. And what we try and do in our UHV systems is save our UHV pump, that being our sputter ion pump, to the place where that's the only pump that's available to get a chamber down below 10 to the minus 9, 10 to the minus 10 torr range. So it's a question of, I guess, optimal operating ranges for those two devices. Brian?
Yeah, no, I agreed that it's using the pump where they're most suited, and the turbo pump, as John said, between that minus 3, just where your roughing pump is, to the minus 6, minus 7, and using that ion pump where it's strength-wise, and really that's when you get really below the minus 6 where you have the most lifetime. I'll give you an example. We've got a pump that used to run in the Varian lobby that the Varian brothers developed and started running in 1952 that was still running because they had it in the minus 9. It'll run almost for an entire lifetime at that lower pressure range. But if you started at the minus 3, you may only get a year out of it. So really being aware of those things makes it to where your equipment will last as long as possible.
Exactly. So there's two things. There would be the consumption of the titanium that's available inside the pump, particularly that very small single cylinder pump that you referenced that the from the original Varian brothers. And I guess the other piece would be that the lower pressure you turn on your ion pump, then you get to operate in the pre-saturation mode, which gives you a significant advantage in pumping speed. So when an ion pump's turned on at very low pressure, it takes there's a finite amount of time that it can operate pre-saturation, so you get almost like a turbo effect, if you will. That's maybe the wrong terminology, but you get a real boost in pumping speed that's available until the pump hits its steady state or saturation, and that would be at the rated pumping speed for that device. But operating up to that point gives you a boost in performance. All right, let's see. We got another ion pump question here. It says, if I've got a turbo pump on my system, why do I need an ion pump? And I think that the main answer there would be that turbopumps, as Brian and I have both said, are incredible devices from getting from 10 to the minus 3 to, let's say, 10 to the minus 10 torr. When I hit around the 10 to the minus 10 torr range, though, I'm going to hit the compression limit for that turbopump. And what's going to happen at that point is that a gas molecule that's in the foreline of my turbopump, so it's gotten through, it's been pumped up by the turbopump itself, is going to be just as likely to find its way backwards through the turbopump up into the chamber as it is to find its way down to the backing pump. So I've hit the limit of my ability to compress gases at that point. And then really my only choices left would be a cryo pump can get to slightly lower pressures, and or even better, I would use some sort of ion pump device at that point. So the answer is that turbopumps there will hit the compression limit, and their effective pumping speed will fall off to near zero pumping speed below that compression limit of 10 to the minus 10 torr. All right, Kim, I'm going to see if we have time for one more question. It's another ion pump question, and maybe, Brian, you can help me out with this one. So the caller's asking, titanium ion pumps work for oxygen and nitrogen, but how do I pump argon at UHV pressures? Brian, do you want to jump in and start with that one?
Yeah, I can. Look, it's you know, everybody thinks of a turbopump and it pumps all the gases, some gases differently at different speeds than others, but on an ion pump where it's a capture, you have to it's easy to take the ones that are reactive gases, because you can react with a titanium, you can embed them. What we're looking at with an argon or the noble gases that are non-reactive, those are more challenging. And so we typically use a noble diode or what we call a triode or a star cell pump that have the ability to pump those gases. So you have to be aware of what your gas load is in your chamber to determine which pump you want to use. So when we look at it, it's about choosing the pump properly, for the system you're using. So if people just want to pump and have a UHB chamber and it's completely clean and maybe they're doing an E-beam or something they're working with, and really at that point the primary gas load in at 10 to the minus 10 is hydrogen. So you want a pump that does the best pumping of hydrogen, which is typically a diode pump. When you have a mixture of gases and you say, well, we're not quite sure, we might have some argon or we might have some other noble gases, choosing a noble diode, noble being we're pumping those noble gases or the non-reactive, or a star cell or a triode pump would be your choice, because you don't know if you've got those gases, so you want to be able to pump them to get to the lowest pressure possible.
Yeah, that's a great answer, and it's really interesting that at those pressures is really the first time we have to try and distinguish or configure a pump to pump different gas species. Let me get one more example of that would be, let's say, in a semiconductor process where it's not necessarily the lowest pressure we can get to that's going to determine the effectiveness of my, let's say, my deposition of my substrate. However, it may be a particular gas species that would interfere with it. Then exactly as you said, you would choose a pump to get rid of that particular species as being the most effective way to affect my deposition onto a surface. Okay, I'm getting a flag from Kim here, and I know we're over time. I'll send it back to Kim to wrap up. But thanks very much for all those questions. Any other questions, feel free to submit them after.
Yes, great. Thanks, John. We are going to have to wrap up right there. Thank you to both of you for spending some time with us today, and thank you to all of our audience members for being a part of this webinar event. Also, if you would like to learn more about Vacuum for Science Research, just select the link behind the resource widget to visit their page on Vacuum Beyond Specifications. Take care, and we'll talk with you soon.